Thank you very much for being with us in this interview. My first question, it's actually a very general one. I would like to ask you to briefly describe the Stapferhaus.
The Stapferhaus, in shortly, the Stapferhaus creates a space to talk about the relevant issues of time. Every year and a half or 2 years, an interactive sensory exhibition on a new topic is inaugurated, accompanied by a range of tailor-made communication formats and diverse events, inviting the public always to critically engage with the present in a hopefully entertaining manner. At the moment, the Stapferhaus, we are showing our exhibition on sex and gender. Right. In German, those two terms translated in one word, it's called Geschlecht. And the exhibition invites everyone to engage with the subject matter in a funny way. For the exhibition, we have completely transformed the whole building. This behind me, you can see this is what it looks at the moment. And as you can see, the Stapferhaus is a kind of museum of contemporary issues. That's why we don't have a classic collection. But instead we with each new project, our collection of stories about the present is growing. Because when we develop our exhibitions, we not only work with experts in the specific thematic areas, but we also work closely with the population. In this exhibition on sex and gender, for example, we want to find out how old and young women and men and everyone in between and beyond life live their gender roles. So it means we ask how feels their gender to be a disadvantage, or who fears the disintegration of classic gender roles, and in general how our gender shapes us in everyday life. To find these answers to the questions, we step outside the Stapferhaus and mingle with the population. And maybe to understand how our exhibition works is the best to watch our short trailer of the current exhibition.
Ich bin eine Frau.
Ich bin ein Mann.
Oh Gott, das ist eine mega komplizierte Frage.
Mega männlich ist zum Beispiel jetzt gerade gesehen, mit der Motorsage Holz versagt hat.
Wenn irgendwie, keine Ahnung, irgendetwas muss umgedreht werden oder so, dann sind wir ja jetzt zwei starke Buben, obwohl die Mädchen auch stark sind.
Wir haben daheim voll den Kampf, weil die Rollenverteilungsaufbruch ist ja, glaube ich, wirklich eine krasse Überforderung für die meisten Leute.
Ich wünsche mir das Geschlecht. Es kann etwas Spielerisches werden, etwas leicht Lustvolles, das alle Menschen ausprobieren können.
What was the history of this awarded museum? Can you summarize a little bit the rationale, the objectives and the aims? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the history is fascinating because the Stapferhaus was founded in 1960, but not as a museum. Instead, as an institution that focused on a goal. And the goal was to encourage dialogue and to constructively negotiate current problems and issues. So till 3 years ago, the Stapferhaus was located in this old building. You can see it. And the founding, and that's really interesting, and I think it's really in the DNA of the Stapferhaus that the founding status of the Stapferhaus was saying, or says, The form in which the goal is achieved is always to be developed anew from each experience. So for 30 years, the Stapferhaus was a kind of conference venue, with kind of round tables we organized, and current issues were discussed. And then in the 1990s, the director at the time looked for new formats that would reach a wider audience. And he organized, among other things, a small exhibition on the topic of Anne Frank, but with the very important addition of Anne Frank and us. And it was the title. And Switzerland Refugee Policy During the Second World War. This topic was very new at this time, and the exhibition was a huge success. It was a really small exhibition, but with a huge success. And I think there the Stapferhaus realized exhibition can really stimulate debates and engage a wide-ranging audience. And this, I think it was a really, we developed this by doing and trying different formats. Since then, the Stapferhaus focused on exhibitions, and with each new project, refined and professionalized this art. But at the time, we didn't have our old building for exhibitions. Among other space, for many years, we used the Zeughaus. It's a disused armory hall. You can see it here. And this armory hall had many disadvantages. As you can see, first of all, it was really ugly. But not just that, the unisolated building that could only be heated professionally was very unecological, not wheelchair accessible, and so neither visitor friendly nor sustainable to operate. But the building had one huge advantage. We could do with it whatever we wanted with this hall. So we could drill holes into the walls, we could change entrances. With every new project, we completely transformed the space into a new world. Here you have some pictures. I mean, which role does money have in our life? Do we believe in God? How do we decide living in a supermarket of opportunities? And where do we feel at home? Just to show how we transformed the building with every new subject in a new building. The growing success of the exhibition led to the Stapferhaus finally being able to build its own house, and we were really excited about it, but also a bit hesitant and afraid, because we were afraid that with a new building, we would end up with a classical museum space that could not longer be transformed. And it became clear to us that we needed a building that had the same qualities of the old armory hall, but would be an improved version of it. A flexible building that could still be transformed with every project. So we announced the architectural competition, and among the finalists, we really found our dream house. You can see it here. It's a building completely out of wood. It functions like a stage. It can be used and projected on in changing different changing ways always, and not only instead the building, but already. Out on the floor, on the front of the building, we can even rebuild and transform it, as you can see here. This is how the Stapferhaus presented itself of the Office for the Truth when it first opened. The theme was the difficulties of dealing with lies and truths. And then 2 years later, we transformed the building again into a world where we interact with issues on sex and gender. The house offers a lot of room for maneuver. We were even able to relocate the entrance. and move stairs and move walls inside so that the scenography and the architecture put themselves at the service of the story we wanted to tell.
Okay, nice. Thank you. And what do you think were the particular qualities or innovations impressing the EMYA prize jury?
Yeah, oh, Mark O'Neill's laudation said it really wonderfully. I mean, we could not, we were really happy because we couldn't say it in a nicer way. He said, the main award goes to a museum which asks difficult questions, explores big ideas, and foster a culture of debate. Through its innovative, creative, and future-oriented approach, it offers a model for the museum as laboratory for the art of living, as all museums should be. So I think we were honored as a museum that chose its own way, that recognized its strong sense of social responsibility, and that strives for dialogue. We listen even when things get on, we listen to the public, to the population, even when things get uncomfortable. At the moment, we have many school classes, they visit us, some of them with many queer pupils. The conversation with them are often very exciting, but sometimes we were also surprised by really homophobic statements. And we have discussed internally how best to deal with this. At first, reaction might be to say, stop, here in the Stapferhaus, there is no place for a statement like this. Homophobic students are not welcome, so you have to go out. But there is little to be gained, I think, from that on this way. That's why we have decided to take different approaches. We ask them, how can a man shot his gay son, and how would that feel as a father? Or why do you think being gay is so terrible? In these instances, we choose a dialogue to talk through, and I think that is exactly the attitude that won us to the award.
Great. Yeah, that's a great attitude to have in an institution. And in that sense, what were the difficulties and positive experiences you had during
the realization? Maybe this example just mentioned the kind of points in that direction. Our problem.
True, yeah, exactly.
It's really difficult to reach all people and break down the dividing walls with a topic that gender and sex is a topic that polarizes opinions, and we often choose topic like that. But it was very important to us that with a topic like sex and gender, we not only reach people who are very gender sensitive and interested in the topic, we especially wanted to reach the others. They interested us just as much, maybe even more. And we not only in the terms of audience for the ratings and the but also the money, but also because we wanted to know what cares them about the topic, why they are annoyed by it. That's where things get really exciting if you ask this question. And if we manage to work out way of an argument and into a conversation, that's the goal from the Stapferhaus and our goal. But of course, it's also very difficult to address everyone. So our tools are poetry, maybe a bit of humor. We try to provide a good atmosphere in the room so that you are like open-hearted. And all our exciting, carefully selected and edited content. I think that's really important, that you can feel that we are really that we really were looking to do it properly and with a lot of respect among everybody. But of course, we had to do a lot of balancing acts too. For example, the toilets. Do we make them for everyone or only for women and men? Then we had all the questions about gender-appropriated languages, which in German they are really intense and also really polarizing. And for example, then when we think of gender, also we think of genitals, because in German both words have the same root, Geschlecht and Geschlechtsteile. And we ask ourselves how we could talk about reproductive organs in an exhibition without it becoming pornographic or creating taboos or standardizing, but still bring the difficult topic to the table. And our solution in this exhibition, we simply let the organs speak for themselves. So a vulva and a penis, voiced by an actor, by actors, and projected onto two plastic models, address the audience in a poetic variety show and talk to them about how people deal with them.
That's really fascinating, fascinating experience. I think you have already touched this, but what do you think are the most important social impacts of this experience?
Yeah, the Stapferhaus reached up to 100,000 people per year without Corona. however, the city in which the Stapferhaus is located has only 10,000 inhabitants. This means that we have to engage with an audience far beyond a local level. But Lenzburg has always been a treasure trove of exciting stories and collaboration for us. When we were working on Geschlecht, for example, we put out a notice for pink and blue toys to decorate two of our exhibition rooms. And people from all over the region from Lenzburg came, brought us their toys, and over coffee told us the stories of the toys and also their stories about gender and roles. And in addition, Lenzburg was one of five places where we interviewed people from all over Switzerland on the topic of equality and the idea of masculinity and femininity. And there is a lot of talk in Switzerland right now about the significant gap between people who live in the city and those who live in the countryside. And Lenzburg is nice because it's somewhere in the middle, which is an exciting position for us as Stapferhaus.
And in what ways does your project relate to different audiences? I mean, I also think you have already spoke a little bit about this, but and what do you think attracts them?
Yeah, on the one hand, we always reach a different target audience also with every new topic we deal with it. For example, we had an exhibition about the role of punishment in society, which many, and I didn't thought on this, but many police corps and police school came to visit this exhibition. And the exhibition was at the time filled, and the exhibition Geschlecht, we certainly have an average queer audience, people who have never been to the Stapferhaus before. And so I think also with our topic, the public is always a little bit changing. And at the moment, we are working on an exhibition about the relationship between man and nature, and many people who work in the field of ecology and environment will certainly be interested. But our declared goal is also and to reach out to others. And of course, this is always the more difficult part of the project. And for this, I think it's important that we consider all these people from the very beginning, from the conception stage, not just in some kind of downstream mediation work, that we take their voices seriously, we ask them, we are really, and that the exhibition and difficult topics don't come across that's not really exhausting to see the exhibition, but that there is always entertaining and stimulating and enjoyable. I think this is really important if you want to reach a wide public.
Also, how has this initiative been impacted with the contingencies of the COVID-19 pandemic? I would like you to comment maybe in what ways the pandemic has changed the project, mm-hmm. also in terms of challenges, but in also in the potentialities.
Mm-hmm. And the two exhibitions we had now in this new building, Fake and Geschlecht, Sex and Gender, were in contrast maybe to other countries not closed for very long. Each shutting down, the doors were closed for maybe twice 2 months. And of course, the restrictions on visitors made things difficult for us. We are mostly self-financed and depend on the admission fees. And yeah, so changing our office to home office, trying to plan a vernissage. And so COVID was demanding a lot of flexibility from everyone also in Switzerland. But it took us exciting new direction also. For example, we introduced the online booking system because we had like the audience was not, we had only 100, I think it was in one time it was 100 people per day we could enter, and it was because it was we had these restrictions. And then we developed also didactic materials for homeschooling, and we added our collection of past exhibition on the website, and we designed an online workshop that is now run by our team worldwide. And this all these things were, they cost a lot, and also resources. We need a lot of resources, but I'm really happy that all these things will still be relevant even after the pandemic is over. So we didn't invent things that we cannot use after COVID. And I hope it will give a life after COVID. So thank you.
It was very nice to meet you. See you.
Thank you. See you. Bye.